way of sort of saying that it is possible, nothing new. Here you can sort of see our system of arrows, moving people through the space, but also at the same time, there was a couple sort of dead points in the space. And then you got to the actual part of the exhibition. And this was a lot of information giving eight different sort of ecosystems of what those Spanish architects were doing. And so us with the curator and a whole research group were in sort of charge of sort of visualizing this. They gave us the sort of raw data. We sort of went back and forth. We were editing the content with them in terms of how to make this interesting. And we had to do this on two levels, one for a book, another for an exhibition. Those are two different types of sort of readers that sort of sees this information. When you're reading a book, you have time to read it, you're ready to sort of captive audience. When you're in an exhibition, you really have to sort of grab the attention of people. So this is a little bit sort of all the information graphics that we did for this. And some of it, what was really interesting is we got to learn a lot about sort of Spanish. Way more than we probably wanted to. And some of the stuff is, for example, this is what we call the academic route. And this was essentially if Rafael Moneo started or received his degree in one university, what was his trajectory to become, go all the way to sort of Harvard? And this was sort of tracing all these sort of professors where they've started in these sort of very small sort of Spanish architecture schools that are not notable, to then go on to very notable sort of institutions. We also took a look at the popularity versus the square footage that architects built. You know, in terms of some architects are very popular. This was Alta Arquitectura is one of the most popular architects by Facebook followers in the world, versus Santiago Calatrava, which is very infamous, has a following, but also has a little bit of infamy, and has built a lot. And so this was to sort of take a look at sort of two ways to achieve fame. And then one of our favorite sort of diagrams was what came first, the croquis or the Pritzker Prize. And so this was a very sort of humorous way to look at how many croquis did you have to be published and have before you got a Pritzker, or versus if you got a Pritzker, how many croquis would you get afterwards, right? So this was like a very light-hearted, sort of funny way to take a look at Spanish architecture. Then all of this, you know, once we had sort of compiled all of this, this kind of became sort of the general aesthetic of the whole exhibition. So you can kind of sort of see, we kind of started with just an identity, you know, and some colors, but that began to influence everything. And then this is the book. And this goes, and that is kind of an interesting exhibition and sort of segue to other ways of communicating in sort of physical space. And one of the big things that we do in the studio is really like to get our hands dirty with the actual content in terms of sort of figuring out ways to edit it or to figure ways that it could be more interesting in terms of how we present it. And this is the next project that we did for Nike is a very heavily edited project in terms of on our side. And essentially what it is, it's we were commissioned by Nike around 2008 before the Beijing Olympics to communicate the history of them as a brand. Meaning everyone knew the shoes and knew of the brand itself or the cachet of the brand, but they may have not known the actual history, the heritage of the brand. And so what we proposed to them was to curate 100 objects from their history, right, to tell their story to sort of the general public. then a second part would be the actual new products, right, which sort of would write the future history for that Olympics. And so when we took a look at these sort of artifacts, we actually went to Portland several rounds to Beaverton, to their headquarters, and we went into actual their archives, their vault, and there was tons of things, more than just photographs, there were advertisements, there was movies, there was actual shoes, materials, drawings, etc., that we all had to sort of condense them to the 100 most important facts. And our reasoning to editing this was that how could we find the 100 most important things that are critical to the history of Nike about lightness, about speed, about performance? And so we started sort of picking those objects, writing stories for each one of those objects. And we also began to think about what is the aesthetic of the space that we're going to present these things. And we knew we had a two-part. We had the 100 objects that are the heritage of Nike, and then we had sort of the new sort of products that were for the So we decided to divide this up into two parts. One part that would be sort of archive, and another part that would be a lab. One that's history, future, one that presents mass quantities of things, and one that sort of presents few things. And this was always kind of sort of our aesthetic that we wanted to sort of follow. One should feel very sort of dense and packed, almost like a museum of natural history, and the other one should feel a little bit more like a science. Obviously, 100 is a slogan, and the Chinese love slogan. So this was what we would call the 100 battles and 100 victories. And that 100, oddly enough, began to influence a lot of other things. Began to influence of the space itself. Within the space, we also had not only to present these sort of artifacts, but we also had to present movies, these sort of like much more saturated experiences. So what we did was essentially we created a bunch of circles and we created, cut a big trench in the middle of it. And that's actually what we would call the trench. And that became essentially a large sort of closet for all these artifacts. And then sort of the lab would just be put on top. So we actually had a wall cut. The other great thing about this project was that construction costs were relatively effective in China, so there were some things that we were able to experiment and do. And this is what we call our triangular facade, which I'll sort of show you maybe. That essentially had sort of three rotating sort of images that would constantly be changing. The best part about this was that since we had such proximity to the manufacturers, we were able to sort of make this a little bit more dynamic than what's normal. We were able to change the motors, the position, we did various tests with this to just to try to get this thing where it would sort of have a moment of a full image. And then it would fade away to sort of between two images, and then it would sort of come up to another full image. So it became sort of a very interesting part of the project. And this is our trench. And we also decided to put trimedia on the ceiling. This is also above the trimedia where we hide all the air conditioning and all sort of the nitty-gritty stuff, which worked really great because when the trimedia would flip, it would just essentially be like a large ventilator. And then this is all the objects. So each one of them was numbered. And this was 2008, so around the time the iPhone started appearing, and we decided to do our first non-app app. This was actually the first time we ever experienced doing an app. And it was essentially a shuffle. You just would flick from picture to picture. It had a soundtrack to it. And you would sort of like go from number to number. Kind of very low tech, but very effective. It was kind of what was available at the time too. And then above was all sort of the new products. Another thing that we do a lot, and this kind of sort of blends and sort of merges a bit into our architecture, is we deal a lot in terms of sort of environments, environmental design. And one of our biggest clients for this has always been sort of Prada. Obviously, OMA designed the New York store, but since the initiation, we were sort of commissioned to do the wallpaper for this store. And the interesting thing about the wallpapers for Prada is that they are the size of a New York block. That's a large amount of wall in a very skinny space. And so we do this project every four times a year. And it's always hard to reinvent the wheel in such a large area that has a very difficult viewing angle. So it has always been a challenge to do this very large thing that you can't see the full thing, but you're always very close to it. And so this is, I almost want to say, like an archive of all the previous years. So it first started in 2001, we're still doing it. It's like 15, 16 years. Some of our first forays into the wallpapers was actually taking pictures of all the fake product being sold outside and sort of collaging it. It was so ugly that we were asked to mask it, and so the first one was actually using that content but somehow making it a little bit more beautiful. And then for the second one, the first one was so difficult, so we just heard that was an idea of just canceling. So every day, this wallpaper would be slowly sort of canceled and sort of disappeared. Another year was actually the idea of sort of the mask games, the Korean mask games, and this was partially inspired by the OMA mannequins that they had sort of picked, which were these very sort of inexpensive, somewhat ugly mannequins. And it was essentially like a Prada army. And they became like a big hit, these kind of odd, kind of very ugly mannequins. And so for the second round, we decided to do this utopia of sort of where the mannequins could sort of roam free without clothes. And even though the mannequins were not male and female, we still had to pixelate parts. And this began sort of a series of various, every time we sort of have to reinvent the wheel for this. Sometimes it's very connected to the collection, sometimes it's based on ideas for the collection. Other times we're kind of sort of given a blank canvas. Sort of go through. This is Notorious Women, which these are sort of like all the very sort of infamous sort of women of sort of history. And then for the second, or the wallpaper thereafter, we kind of sort of made them all sort of terroristic, like terrorists, and just covered them up with sort of very beautiful sort of mask. Sometimes these are sort of, we bring in illustrators that we really admire. it's almost, it's a much more production-based project, where it's not as simple just sort of like you print this large wallpaper. Even though it takes a lot to sort of design sort of these wallpapers, but in this instance, what we did was a collage of two tropes, sort of classical painting. One was English landscapes, and the other one was female nudes. And we had these actually oil painted in a Chinese village, where they sort of do all these sort of fake paintings. And so this became like this really large, enormous, oil painted canvas collage. And the funny part was, like, since there were so many different people painting these bits and parts that we actually took from classical paintings, you would get a different artist sometimes on certain parts of the bodies or certain parts of the landscapes, etc. Other times these are sort of collages that we do based on a collection. Other times I actually have sort of photographs from the collection. This is with sort of brutalist architecture, etc. This is a never-ending kind of project, but a really great project for the office. Another kind of environment that we've sort of done, and I think this kind of is similar to what we do for Prada, but also very different, is IIT. This is a little bit sort of classic 2x4 project. And IIT is a student center in the middle of Chicago. And designed by Rem and OMA, the idea was that the student center would connect many different parts of this somewhat dangerous neighborhood. The more connectivity, the danger would sort of cease to go away. And Rem's proposal for us was that we had to make the student center sort of lively and active. And so when we took a look at this and we knew that it needed some sort of twist, right? We decided to do a bunch of research in sort of colleges, Ivy Leagues, etc. What we began to find is that in these old buildings, there was actual jokes. There was sort of humors within the frieze. So this is a bunch of the students sleeping during class, drinking and looking at pornography. And so what we decided to do was to include that sensibility of sort of jokes, etc., within, hit it within the building. And so what we did was we decided to take the international sort of man icon, or bathroom icon. We decided to take that icon through a series of different activities. We did a lot of things. And we actually had to take some of these out, because they were too, I guess, not a risque. These are some that were taken out. And essentially what these icons provided was just essentially like a building block for us to build other things. So we were able to sort of build faces, etc. And so one of the things that we did was to have images of all the founders of IIT. And so this is Mies van der Rohe, our important people to IIT. And this is what we call Mies' mouth, where his sort of mouth opens up because it's a door. Founders. But when you look very closely, you would find those jokes or you would find those activities. Sometimes they would appear at larger scale, even smaller scale for acoustical materials, etc. The last thing that we do, which is very directly related to architecture, is signage and wayfinding, and that's essentially how people navigate a building. And we've done various different projects, but this is one that probably most people will know. two towers that have, let's say, the same floor, 15. Right? There's a total of sort of 44 floors in the whole building. But on one tower, you could be on floor 15, but you could be on the wrong floor 15. Right? And so we discussed a lot, and this was a very ongoing conversation with them, about how to name things. The project, by the time we had been brought on board, had been around in the office almost six and a half years. So everyone was very used to calling it what, using the nomenclature that they've always used, which was A, B, C, D. That was all tied to certain programmatic parts of the building. But when we came on board, we looked at this and said, this does not make sense from a user standpoint. No one's going to call this A, B, C, D. Why would you enter on C? Why would you enter on E? So we went, we had a lot of conversations about this with MoMA and Rem. And we finally came to the conclusion from a user standpoint, it's much easier to think of this as two towers that kind of meet. In terms that we have one entrance, entrance one, entrance two. Obviously, this was the worst last thing that Rem wanted to hear because he always thought the building was this continuous loop of sort of productivity. And so instead of having A, B, C, D, E, F, what we had was tower one and tower two. We had entrance one, entrance two. And we also went very, did a deep dive in terms of how to draw this building and how to express plans, sections, elevations, etc. When's that moment you need these things? Obviously, this is an office building, but it's an office building for 10,000 workers. And so the only person that ever does that whole circuit is probably the janitorial staff or the CEO of CCTV. So, one of the things, you know, looking at this and what made this project also very complex is how do you go from one place to another place? We had other elevator banks that were very complicated. We had double lifts. We had sort of lifts that went directly to floor 38. We had transfer floors. We had all these things. This operated almost like a train station. So we had to sort of like actually think of it as a train station, right? And so this is one way that we drew the building, which is not true to what the building is. This is a fictional section. But this kind of shows you how to get from one place to another using sort of the train or elevators. We also took a deep dive and sort of taking a look at sort of the materiality of this. Now what was very different than IIT and other projects that we've sort of done like OMA is we could not be loud and this is an office building. It's not something that could be so spirited or festive. And so what we decided was to take a look at these two types of areas that were defined actually by OMA in their drawings. They had special areas and generic areas, where special areas were lobbies, transfer floors, etc. And then generic areas were your basic sort of cookie cutter office areas. And so we decided that we would, in these special areas where you wanted to allow, announce these sort of areas that are much, that are more publicly significant, such as studios, canteens, etc., that we would be larger in scale, and that we would have a tone to the material that would be integrated to what that material would be. And in these generic areas, we would be hyperly generic. So we were either hyperly specific or hyperly generic. And we essentially did an A3 system, right, of signage. So we felt that nothing could be more generic than putting like an A3 or A4 on the wall. And so this is a little bit of sort of like our material palette. This was kind of sort of a reaction to to what those materials were in terms of sort of lobbies, lift lobbies, studios, and then just basic offices. Sometimes there were sort of executive offices that were special, etc. So this is the way that our maps, our nomenclature, everything kind of sort of came together at different scales. And then there was one area that we were able to do something, what we considered fancy for the project, was we had this large canteen and we were sort of essentially commissioned to make it something graphic and something more interesting. And we did a lot of sort of research on what that could be, and the client finally decided on something that was somewhat traditional. But we decided to give it that twist of making it pixelated, but also very sort of handcrafted in terms. We were very specific in terms of the tile, the blue, the size of the tile, etc., how we would sort of render that image, so that when you're up close, you wouldn't even notice that it's an image. But when you were sort of far away, you would. We also affected sort of the landscaping and the signage around the site. And OMA had a proposal which was essentially these sort of round pixels that was everywhere on the landscape. Sometimes it'd be trees, it'd be flowers, etc., they'd be pavers. And so what we decided was, well, let's use what we sort of have at the moment, that pixel. And we said there's only really two signs that you need, a place that sort of identifies a location, and another sign that tells you how to get to another location that's not nearby, so essentially a map. And so we decided, when it's a location, we're going to use a full pixel and extrude it. And when it needs to give you more information, we're going to cut it. Very basic. I mean, we did several studies on how to cut this at angles and different ways. I know it seems very simple. It took us a long while just to come to the very simple conclusion of a half circle. And this kind of sort of formed the whole sort of site center. Heights, studying the heights of those in relation to the context of the neighborhood, the other buildings, how tall were their signs, ours needed to be a little bit taller. And then the last thing that we do is what we call sort of interactive experiences. And this deals more or less with our give you a certain example of this. So in working with sort of foster partners, they had a ticket booth in front of their performance center, which they had designed, and they had sort of specified this large digital wall. They didn't know what was going to be on that wall. And they asked us to sort of think about this, but they knew that they needed something special, so it wouldn't be a screen. And so we thought a lot about this, and we said, well, it's a performance center, why can't we just sort of like get a feed from what's going on inside and express what's going on inside the performance center to the outside? And they said, yes, that sounds like a great idea, but there's all these legal issues, meaning you can't just take content that people paid for and then display it on the outside. We said, okay, so what could we use? And so we decided that we knew that AT&T was their main sponsor. We knew that a lot of people, there was free Wi-Fi on that sort of campus. We knew that a lot of people might be tweeting or need information. And so we decided to pick up on that feed, essentially, of that available information on the cloud. And we began to sort of use that. So it would be a mix, a combination of sort of what was programmatically happening, text-based, but also sort of Twitter, etc. And so we devised this sort of system that essentially is kind of somewhat like origami, or almost like envelope sort of folding, like paper. And we gave it a color palette, which was defined for us by the sponsor, by AT&T. intention created these sort of animated sort of wall that would sort of open in pockets. So what we decided is to come up with various different themes to essentially say, this content's not the most important content that we need to be able to legibly read, but it needs to provide some sort of atmosphere. And that began a whole series of work in terms of other interactive walls, exteriors, etc. for Chanel, in terms of how to create ambience without having full resolution, but also taking advantage of sort of the actual space and sort of the building. This is sort of a larger scale project where interactively kind of becomes somewhat of an art. The last one I want to show you is probably one of the projects that is larger in scale in terms of amount of screens that we affected. And it was 2 years ago, there was the first time the NYC Design Fair event in New York. And we were sort of commissioned to sort of think of a way of providing something that solidified the community of designers, whether they're architects, graphic designers, industrial designers within New York, to bring them together to have some sort of say-so within New York City. And I'll sort of show you, our idea was to do a multi-festival, which was essentially so essentially, everyone would submit three words. And it's essentially their thoughts about sort of design, their sort of manifesto towards design. And we kind of created a very simple interface. It's a very simple idea. It's just a website that you put your email, put your three words. Had to be a verb, preposition, and noun, so like very straightforward. But then what it began to do was because we were working with the city in the mayor's office, we were actually able to place this on every screen in New York, from Times Square to every cab. So in a way, this was like a very large project that everyone saw that was probably the simplest.
least interesting moments?
Well, I think in a way there's not an idea to that, like a formalized idea, but there's like a general reaction to that in terms that we have to kind of react within the context that we're in. And our idea is that we still want to be ambitious, and we still want to work on big projects, and we do work on big projects. But there's still smaller projects within the office that are much more important. And so in a way, it's kind of a mix of those things. And I think in a way, it's not that different than what you would find in New York. You know, there's still, even though we show a lot of the big projects, it's just nobody wants to see the little ticket labels that we did sort of for Barney's, because it's not the most important thing, even though it's a very recognizable client. But it's not the most important project.
But where does the social responsibility projects kick in? Like, where is the moment where all this design intelligence goes into something else?
In terms of social responsibility?
I mean, I guess the New York project is a bit...
big corporate versus...
Yeah. Well, I think in a way, it's kind of very hard to say because the office has never had a distinctive aesthetic. It's never had a distinctive idea. It's never had been about sort of very defined edges, right? And I think our clients also come in that way. So there are projects that we have done that are sort of pro bono for, let's say, like a finished project. But it was like a woman's shelter in Africa, which we did all the signage, right? It's just that sometimes they're not always the most visually compelling projects, or sometimes we've done smaller institutions, right? So they exist. Being the first time here in Istanbul, I kind of wanted to bring my A game instead of the B sides. I don't know, that could be a whole separate. The B sides.
In some ways, I guess the current climate here is somehow very open to projects, so it becomes this kind of impulse to ask, what else is there aside from the projects?
There's a lot. I mean, within Madrid, we're doing a couple identities, which are very, for a small gallery. There is smaller things. The actual exhibition is a very small project in terms of architectural.
I have a question. So, as a firm, how do you balance both your own creative vision with the needs of the client? For you guys, is there a particular process that you go through in order to kind of get the right mix?
We produce a lot. It's a good way. Well, one thing that we always try to do is overproduce, which is not the most economically viable model. But what we try to do is, as much as possible, we don't consider it almost like a neither nor position. It's the client's and it's ours. And I think more than anything, what we try to do is engage a dialogue where either even though there are moments of sort of contention in the project, we try as much as possible to sort of like remain positive about it, but also at the same time use that as the crux of where the design comes from. That sort of thing, that moment of, I don't know, we want this, but they want that. Be surprised, there's a lot of good stuff that kind of sort of happens, that negotiated.
Wayfinding is a difficulty, we already know, and this type of building is probably about that. But how do you give this feeling to people when you're using the Chinese alphabet? Because you know, in Latin, for example, they are stencils or something that you motivate people to do certain reactions and show findings. But how about working on the Chinese alphabet? For example, do you know Chinese? Probably not.
I've lived 7 years.
That's why I got my question. Maybe you tell us about what we, you know.
Well, I think in all our projects, whether we're China, Japan, or Doha, Dubai, or here, there would always be someone that we need as locally to help us understand what typographically things are correct. And those people are super important for us. So for example, when I showed you Tower 1 and Tower 2 in Chinese, there's 5 different ways of writing how to say 1 and 2, right? Which you'd write differently, right? And so to say 1 and 2, what we chose was actually not the very normal way of saying it because it confuses it with the floor numbers. But we actually chose a more, I'd say, almost a celestial way to sort of call the numbers. And so what that allowed us to do was to differentiate those things. So in any of our projects, we always have to have someone who helps us to guide through that. Obviously, I did not know that at the time, but we had sort of 3 staff members that now run the Beijing office that guided us through that. And so typographically, since there are sort of things about tone, about sort of local culture, those are the people that sort of help us. We also have to remember our studio is multicultural. There's people speak Spanish, Korean, there's a lot of different people that sort of come in and out of the office. Any other questions?
So that's everything was so clear and so perfect to me. My question is about how did you work with all these big companies? Do you find them first or they are coming with you?
In
the first beginning, for example, of course,
yeah.
After a moment there you become known and they are with you.
Well, you also haven't taken into consideration the office has been around for 18 years. So in the very beginning, nobody called. And obviously, I wasn't even around. And it was started by 3 people. So it was Mike Rock, Susan Sellers, and Georgie Staff. And the first couple of years, they had it really tough. Right? But what the origins of the office is essentially, they were given a little project. At the moment, it was little. It was to do a redesign for the NE magazines. I mean, it was like nobody knew any. People knew computer housing was, but there were difficult magazines to read. And they did a whole bunch of those. A lot of those magazines. And because of that, that sort of cemented a relationship with Rem and other architects and kind of sort of like cemented us who we were as an office in terms of one of the few graphic design offices working with the architects. There weren't that many. This is sort of like the mid, early 90s. And so it kind of sort of rolled from there. Now we have kind of sometimes the liberty.
so much.